Well, good morning. Welcome to New Hope Community Church. It's great to have you with us today. I hope you've had a great week and a Merry Christmas, and it is a joy to have you for the very last Sunday of 2015. Thanks for being here. A little cold this morning, wasn't it? So it's a reason for a sweater and a jacket. I may be shucking it before the service is over, but at 5 a.m. it felt really, really good. You probably already kind of got the announcement out as you came in. If you have a need for private facilities today, don't wait too awful long because it's a longer walk than normal. You need to go over to the office for restrooms today. We have two different wells here. One well works three buildings. One well works the office. The one well that works the three buildings, not very well today. The pipes apparently have frozen, all right? It's first time in all of my years here. It's been colder at night than it was last night, but probably not as long. I left here just before 8:30 last night, and it was already 32, 33 here. And when I left my house this morning coming here, it was 25 degrees. So freezing was a long time last night. The sun is shining on those cold pipes, so they will warm up maybe by the next service, all right? And if you've come with a cold heart today, the sun would love to shine in your heart and warm it up a bit today. He would be happy to do that. But thanks for being here. If on the last Sunday of the year it is your first Sunday at New Hope, welcome. It is our pleasure that you chose New Hope as your place of worship. There are some communication cards in the pew. I would love for you to fill one out, put it in the offering a little later when it comes by. And guys, this is appropriate for Christmas. Here comes Joseph and Mary. It is. That's Joseph and Mary. It really is. All right. I love it. I love it. All right, it's almost as good as having a bishop for a pastor here, all right? So it's pretty cool. But we'd love for you to put that card in the offering, and next week through the mail we'll send you information of what goes on around New Hope. We try not to annoy you, but through the mail give you some helpful information that might encourage you to want to come back, check out some other of the ministries that go on around here. Talking about other ministries, they're not going to be happening this week. Nothing really is going on this week around the church. It's New Year's week, and so pretty quiet week around here. But things are going to get started the next 2 weeks after that. So let me highlight a few of those things. First off, except Celebrate Recovery. Yes, they will be taking place Thursday night, New Year's Eve night. You ought to have a big party. Big party. A lot of punch. A little potluck. Okay, that's awesome. That is great. So, Celebrate Recovery will be meeting on Thursday evening. Starting January the 10th, that is a... Yes? Oh, nothing. Okay. January 10th. Teddy and Corey, our small group directors, all right, are kicking off our small group outreach this year. And it's going to be a night of worship and fellowship. Let me just clarify. Teddy, you're not leading the singing?
No.
Okay, all right. Just checking, all right? These things like I do in the shower, so I've been told. I've never heard him in the shower, but it's just what I've been told, all right? sometimes it's not good to freelance. But anyway, January the 10th at 6 o'clock. If you are part of a small group, man, show up. We would love to hear some testimonies that night. If you're not part of a small group, show up, and they'll help get you connected to a small group. Would love to have you that night, all right? And any questions, you can contact Teddy, and his email and phone number is in the bulletin. Starting January the 13th, that happens to be my sister's 66th birthday. Did I say that out loud? I said that out loud. Next service. I'll be ready for that one. Anyway, that's a Wednesday night. Two things kick off that night. Our Jam Kids ministry. All right, so to our kids that are from, you know, preschool through junior high age, that will kick off that night. And on that same night, we're offering a class for parents and or grandparents. All right? If you bring your kids to Jams, instead of leaving them and coming back in an hour, why don't you decide to stay, all right, for those 7 weeks or 6 weeks? And there's a class being offered called Raising Kingdom Kids. It's a class that the material was written by one of my favorite pastors and preachers, Tony Evans, and it's called Raising Kingdom Kids, and it's going to be facilitated by Corey Gallardo. And if you would consider attending that, we would love for you to sign up. Tell us how many of you are coming, one, two, or four, but sign up so they have plenty of materials for that night, and that's going to be starting the 13th, and it will end February the 24th. Widow's Lunch Bunch kicking off on January the 17th. If you have any questions, you can call Sally Wan, and that information is there for you as well. Men's Tuesday night Bible study that Jeans lead, it's going to start 2 weeks from this Tuesday night, same night the women's kickoff for 2016, so that will be 2 weeks from this Tuesday night. The men's early morning Bible study that's on Thursday mornings at 6 a.m. goes from 6 to 6:45. We're going to be launching a new study called Fight, Winning the Battles That Matter Most. And so, men, we'd love to have you come and join us at 6 a.m., get acquainted with about 20 other guys in the fellowship, and let's look at how we win the battles that matter the most in our lives. Let me highlight a couple of prayer requests. Some of you have heard, some of you possibly have not yet, but a little after 1 o'clock on Sunday, Christmas Day in the afternoon, we got the call that Shelly's mom had passed away. And so Shelly's in Modesto with her sister and her brother, helping them with some plans. It appears that this is probably going to be a week from Monday in Turlock. So if you would just be remembering to pray for the Ladd family. For those four kids, it's been 112 days from the time that Shelly's dad passed away till the day that Shelly's mom passed away. So just almost right on the money, 3.5 months. So they would appreciate your prayers very much. And then I would appreciate this afternoon after our last service at 2 o'clock, I have a memorial service, and it's going to be one of the toughest ones I've ever done. I'm not even sure. In fact, I asked that question why I was asked to do it. I was told by the son that we're agnostics. The only reason that you're invited is because we have relatives who would be offended if we didn't have a little dose of Jesus. He's a combination attorney CPA. It's an interesting combination. The worst about both, okay, are resident. After listening a lot, I finally said, here's the deal. You contacted me. I'm a pastor. The only hope I know is Jesus Christ. I have never charged for a funeral in my life. I occasionally get asked to MC events, and I'm quite expensive to be an MC. But Which do you, and it's okay if you want to ask somebody else, but you need to know I'm not a hellfire and damnation preacher, but I will share the hope in Jesus Christ. And so he hasn't fired me yet, and it's 2 o'clock today, but just be praying. And my desire, I have to be careful I'm not jaundiced towards him, because he needs to know the love of Christ and the hope of Christ. And so just be praying between now and 2 o'clock. And then just got word that Jane's nephew that lives in Oregon, Jane Lindbergh, battling cancer of the throat, and it's back for the third time. So if you would just be remembering to pray for him, they would appreciate that so very much. So those are a few of the updates we wanted to bring to you. Going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us. Here's the deal for all of our regular church folks. This is the last Sunday that you can get your tax-deductible contribution in, all right? It's your last Sunday to get caught up, okay, if you have fallen behind. It's a great Sunday to start if you've never started. If you're new to New Hope, here's the deal. And the folks sitting around you who are regulars here know nobody has ever received a letter from New Hope saying, give more. You've never received a letter asking or begging for you to give. I don't know who does and who doesn't much, all right? That's not my purview. Don't care to have all that information at my disposal. Here's what I do know. I tried it even as a pastor to hold on to everything that I had. And you know what? It was never, ever enough. When it finally got through to me that the tithes and offerings are a testimony of faith. It's not a requirement for a life with God, but it's a testimony of faith that God can do more with my less than I can do with my all. That if I hold on to all of it, then it's up to me to make sure there's enough to go around, or I suffer the consequences. If I trust Him with the first fruits, the way the Old Testament describes it, if I trust Him with my first fruits, I don't have to worry about my last fruits being taken care of. And all I can tell you is Shelley and I have proven that again and again and again these last 8 years. And I'm so grateful for that. Message over. Let's pray. By the way, Chris wrapped up on Christmas Eve night our Advent conspiracy that we have been talking about since the last Sunday of November. Worship fully, spend less, give more, love all. And the offering on Christmas Eve night, all of that is going to the rescue mission for Rescue the Children Ministry, helping children who are out on the streets. And so if you weren't here Christmas Eve night and you spent less so that you could give more, if you want to put that more that you missed out on Christmas Eve in an envelope and write on it Rescue Mission or Rescue the Children, we will add that to the offering that we had on Christmas Eve night, and that will be an end-of-the-year gift to the Rescue Mission for that new program that they have, which is helping children that are homeless. So we thought we should share that with you. If you spent less, you got more to give. Now the message is over. Let's pray. Father, I love you, and I'm so grateful for this season that is called Christmas. The entire world paused and gave a nod in your direction, whether they've trusted in you, whether they believe in you or not, in some form or fashion. They gave a nod towards you this year. And Father, I trust that because of that emphasis, my prayer is that hundreds, if not thousands, of men and women and boys and girls for the very first time embraced the babe of Bethlehem as the Savior of their heart. And Father, I thank you for hearing their prayer and inviting them and welcoming them into your family. Father, as we end this year and are about ready to begin a new one, I pray that as we reflect and as we anticipate, we will do so with our attention focused on you. Father, the temperature was cold outside. Kind of reminds me of a song I've heard a lot these last few weeks. But it's cold outside. But the sun is shining now. And it's warming the pipes of our well, and it's warming the temperature of the earth. But Father, there may have been some folks who showed up at church today whose hearts are cold, and your sun would like to shine brightly and warm them up. And I hope that by the worship and by your message this morning, we will allow your love to warm our hearts. Thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing testimony, Father, of your grace to us and our faith in you. We give to you today, not with grudge, not with anger or bitterness, but Father, we give to you today with an open heart, and we say thank you for meeting our needs. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Also, at the beginning of the service, I was informed that by the Weldies that their son fell during this week and shattered his kneecap, so going to be in store for probably some surgery this next week or two, so please be remembering to pray for them. If you have your Bibles and you brought them, I would love for you to turn to Matthew chapter 2 in just a couple of minutes. We're going to be reading about five verses, verses 7 and 8, verses 16, 17, and 18 out of Matthew chapter 2. As we are in this last week of 2015, we're going to look back a little bit at the Christmas story as we look forward to the coming year. And so that's the wonderful thing about the Scriptures is they're timeless. So even though Christmas is past, there are some messages, there are some truths out of the Christmas story that I think have some pretty good bearing as we approach that pivotal date of December 31st and January 1st, kind of a day of demarcation between the old is finished and the new has come. You see, most of the players that are involved in the Christmas story, they inspire us with their faith. When you look at Mary, and she received the news that though she was a virgin, she was going to bear in her womb the Son of God. By faith, she was extremely courageous. The shepherds, let me back up. How about Joseph, the engaged husband-to-be? He inspires us with his obedience. First, I'm always impressed with his humility in that Joseph was going to deal with a matter that was touchy for him, but he was going to do it privately. He was going to do so gracefully. And after the angelic visitation was over, Joseph, by faith, became obedient to the will of his heavenly Father for him to be the earthly father of God the Father's Son. And then the shepherds, they inspire us. Those shepherds, they left their fields quickly so they could arrive in Bethlehem and worship Christ fully. And then, of course, the wise men, how many of them there were? Two or more. But these men traveled far and they gave generously. All of these characters inspire us in our faith. And most of the characters in the Bethlehem drama lived like heroes. If this was a melodrama, man, the music would be playing on the high end of the piano right now. But as in every melodrama, there's always a villain. And there's a villain in the Christmas story. And the piano would be playing down here on the low notes right now. And the scripture in Matthew records the villain this way. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, he determined from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and he said, "Go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him," in other words, "I'm not interested in looking for him. But when you have found him, bring back word to me that I can come and worship him also." Did Herod really want to worship him? No. False worship. False worship. Then Herod, when he saw that he was deceived by the wise men, he was exceedingly angry. Not because he missed the chance to worship, but Herod was playing king of the hill, king of the mountain. And he sent forth and put to death all of the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all of its districts from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet hundreds of years before. And Jeremiah said, "There's a voice that was heard in Ramah. There was lamentations and weepings and great mourning. Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted because they are no more." Herod and the Magi, they share the same chapter in the Bible, but they do not share the same heart. All of us at this moment are sharing the same sanctuary. The question is, do we share the same heart? And I can't answer that for you, but I can ask you, whose heart are you more closely aligned with today? The hearts of Mary and Joseph, some shepherds and some wise men, or Herod? The The wise men traveled a great distance to see, to find Jesus Christ. Herod refused to leave his own city. Wise men presented their treasures so they could honor and show their love to the Christ child. Herod attempted to kill him. The wise men saw Jesus, but Herod, he couldn't stop looking at himself in the mirror. That's all he saw. As a result, Herod's obituary forever contains this sad epitaph: the first person to reject Jesus Christ. Dean Farrar, he was a 19th century British scholar, in his book gives this sobering assessment of King Herod. His whole career was red with the blood of murder. Deaths by strangulation, by burning, by being cleft asunder, by secret assassination, confessions that were forced by unutterable tortures, acts of insolent and inhuman lust. The survivors during his lifetime were even more miserable than the martyrs. Herod killed three of his own sons because of jealousy that they might want his throne. Caesar Augustus once said about King Herod, "It is better to be Herod's hog than his son." What was Herod's problem? Here's the sad part, folks. I'm going to suggest to you that what was Herod's problem then is a lot of people's problems now. And it might even be yours. It has been mine. It might be yours. I suggest to you there were three initial problems with Herod. First of all, it was his pride. Herod was hooked on his own importance, of who he had made himself to be. Second, his arrogance. His arrogance blinded his views of Christ. The attorney accountant that I visited with this week for 15 minutes waxed eloquent on the speed of light and how far the closest star is from us and the other stars that have been seen by the Hubble telescope that are billions of miles away, and how that he believes in the person of Jesus, and he was probably an alien that came from that far away and able to travel that far to us earthlings. He would seem like a god. That's kind of what I said. That I got to be honest, that takes more faith for me, all right, than believing God did it, okay? But see, the arrogance of his own intellect and education blinded his view of Christ, did Herod's. Herod's ego was threatened the very moment he heard the Magi ask him the question, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews?" Because Herod, "I'm the King of the Jews and everybody else in my region." It's interesting, just as the same shaft of light in a barn can cause birds to sing beautifully, it prompts rats to scurry quickly. The same message stirred worship of wise men also activated the anger of Herod. You see, Herod knew enough to realize that the star and the scriptures were a forecast of a Messiah. But he used that knowledge to carry out, not worship, but infanticide. The key thing for us to learn from this is believing is not the same as obedience. Believing is not the same as repentance. Herod believed that Jesus was who he said he was. That's what scared him to death. But he didn't trust. The Bible goes a step further and it says, even Satan and his angels believe, and yet they tremble. You may believe there is a God, but do you believe and trust in God? There's a big difference. There's a big, big difference. You see, pride eclipses the right choice from us. Even when we know the truth, our pride prevents us from acting on the truth. You've heard the old quote, right? Love is blind. Yeah, love is blind. I will suggest to you today that pride is blinder. That probably is not good grammar. But you understand it, don't you? You see, Herod's pride hurt other people. And doesn't it always? Doesn't pride always hurt other people? How many apologies has self-importance silenced? How many times have you felt too big to apologize to another person? How many compliments has arrogance muted? How many times have you not said, "Wow, you look gorgeous in that dress," because you wanted somebody to say that to you? I wonder how many preachers have not said to other preachers, "Great sermon," because they were waiting to hear the same thing. Pride, arrogance. How many broken hearts trace their wounds to somebody stubborn, unwielding, "It is my way," or "It is the highway" attitude? You see, not only pride hurts other people, but haughtiness hurts other people. Remember one of the games, I alluded to this a moment ago, remember one of the games we played as kids when there was a mound of dirt or a grassy knoll? We called it Key to the Mountain, right? The rules were very simple, but they were also brutal. Fight your way to the top and shove and push anybody who threatens to take your spot. It was a slugfest of crawling, pushing, pulling, and falling. The sad thing is, King of the Mountain is not just a kid's game. Versions are played out in every college dormitory, in every school classroom, in every business boardroom, and I will even suggest in your bedrooms. And I'm not talking about romance now. And since mountaintop real estate is limited and expensive, people get shoved around all the time. Mark this down. If you want to be keen, somebody is going to suffer. If you want to be keen, somebody is going to pay the price. Oh, I realize that our uppityness, that's a tough word to say, I realize that our uppityness won't prompt a Bethlehem massacre, but it's very possible it could prompt a broken marriage, a damaged friendship, a divided working office, and I've seen it split churches. Pride comes at a high price. Don't pay the price. Consider the counsel of Paul in the New Testament in Romans 12:3 when he says, "Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought." G.K. Chesterton, a preacher of a previous generation, said, "How much larger your life would be if yourself could become smaller in it." He goes on to say, "You would break out of this tiny and tawdry theater in which your own little plot is always being played, and you would find yourself in a freer sky." But listen to what God has to say about it. Proverbs 8:13, God gets right to the point. Five words. "I hate pride and arrogance." Any confusion about what he means? Pretty direct. I hate pride and arrogance.
Proverbs 11:2, when pride comes, guess what follows? Disgrace. When pride comes, then comes disgrace. Proverbs 13:10 says, pride only breeds quarrels. There's never peace when pride is present. Pride goes before destruction. Pride precedes the fall. Proverbs 16:18. What's the antidote to pride? Humility. Yeah, right on, Joseph. Humility. And here's the problem. Humility is slippery. The moment you think you have it, you've just lost it. Okay, it's gone. But here's my suggestion today. Let's pursue it anyway. Even though it's slippery, let's pursue it anyway. The recurring message of Scripture is that God loves the humble heart. It's why the relationship with God starts with the humility of repentance. I am a sinner. Not that I'm a good person. Not that I'm better than so-and-so and not as bad as somebody else. Not, God, you ought to be proud that I've decided to be part of your family. But God, your perfect son. I hate it when it's not there. Your son died on a cross, and he did it because I'm a sinner. Not because Adam sinned. Not because Mussolini was horrible. Not because Hitler was a tyrant. Not because Sirhan was a murderer. And not because, what's the other guy down there with Sirhan? Yeah, Charles Manson was just evil. But Jesus Christ died on the cross for their sins, just as he died for my sins. It starts with humility. Humility. Jesus said, I am gentle and I'm humble in heart. The psalmist said, though the Lord is supreme, he takes care of those who are humble. If your heart is prideful, who takes care of you? The one who's king of the mountain, and that be you. But if we're humble in heart, the scripture says, God takes care of us. God says through the prophet Isaiah 57:15, I live with the people who are humble. And Isaiah goes on to say in 66:2, these are the ones I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite. And here's a beautiful benefit of being humble. God gives to the humble his treasures. His treasures. Proverbs 15:33 says, to the humble I will give honor. The one who wants to be the king who sits on the throne, the one who wants to be on the mountaintop, what's he wanting? He's wanting to be given honor. But he often has to demand it in order to get it. God says, if you're humble of heart, I will give you honor. Proverbs 11:2 says, when you are humble of heart, I will give you wisdom. 1 Peter 5:5 says, to those who are humble, I will give you grace. God's riches at Christ's expense, not giving me what I do deserve, but giving me what I don't deserve. Grace. Might be my all-time favorite word in the human vocabulary. Grace. I need it more than anything and don't deserve it at all. Grace. God loves humility and he hates arrogance. He gives treasures to the humble. But what does he say about pride and arrogance? We've already mentioned Proverbs 8:13, I hate it. Every proud heart is an abomination to the Lord, Proverbs 16:5 says. Just as he gives grace to the humble, God opposes the proud. In Proverbs 16:18, a proud attitude brings ruin and destruction. Learn a lesson from the sad life of Herod. I had a great visit in recent weeks with a man who A man who was raised in a godly home, was raised by parents who love Christ. Got to his college years and did what many college students do. Their faith was their parents. And now when they have freedom, they launch off on their own. A lot of heads nodding. Your kids have been there. Guess what? So is this pastor's kids. They got to figure it out for themselves. You see, they've got to own their own faith. And college, that age, it's a dangerous time. We'd love to prevent our kids from going through it, but we can't. It's got to become their own. And this gentleman told me, he said, Tim, I've known since I was a small child, grew up in church, but I chose to do my own thing. I didn't want to be told what to do anymore. And he said, yet there were all of these roadblocks along the way. My parents would invite me to church. They would special occasions. They would find all ways to try to trick me into coming to church. But I didn't. And I kept doing things, listen to this, this was important. I kept doing things my way. And he said, you know, I look back now and I see that God was all along my process of my life. God was trying to get my attention and say, hey, but before it gets more serious, trust me. And he said, the next thing got a little worse. And I could hear God saying, hey, before it gets worse, trust me. Hey, before it gets worse, trust me. And he said, it's gotten worse and worse and worse. He said, finally, I figured out the other day. Maybe God's been trying to get my attention all along. I said, do you think? I said, let me tell you with my own kids. I remember Brant coming home one day. He was about 20 years of age. Gotten pulled over by a Clovis cop. He said, I hate this town. He said, I can't get away with anything. It was at that moment I told him that's why I bought you a red car. And since I'm a police chaplain in Clovis, I've told every, at that time I could tell every officer, I knew them. I've told every officer, be on the lookout, that's my son, don't let him get away with anything. And I said, but here's the deal, son. You have a heavenly father who's better connected than your earthly father. And what I've come to believe about us kids who were raised in godly homes. The Bible says it this way, to whom much is given, much is required. See, Brad asked the same. He said, Dad, other guys mess up far worse than I do and they don't get caught. I said, and just maybe they didn't have the background that you've had that should have prevented you from being so foolish. But you can continue. But trust me, the Bible says, to those whom God loves, He chastens, He disciplines, He catches you, and there's a price to pay. Maybe some of you were here today for the last Sunday of the year because you didn't want to come Christmas Sunday and be called a cheester or a creaster, that Christmas Easter thing. And so you've come the last Sunday of the year. Learn a lesson from the sad life of Herod. It's always better to step down from the pedestal than to be pulled off of it. Like the innkeeper, Herod missed an opportunity to see Jesus. God did everything necessary to get Herod's attention. He sent messengers from the east, and he brought to him a message out of the Torah. He sent wonders from the sky, and he sent words from the scriptures. He sent the testimony of the heavens, and he also brought to Herod the teaching of the prophets. But Herod refused to listen to it all. He chose his puny dynasty over Christ. Do you know how Herod ended his life? A miserable old man. Realizing that this is a quote from a history book. realizing how the people disliked him. Herod ordered his sister and her husband Alexas to slay all the leaders in the hippodrome at the moment of his death. Do you know why? Because he wanted to ensure national mourning rather than a festival. He knew how badly he was hated. That when the people got word that he had died, they would throw a party. So he said, kill everybody else too. They'll mourn them and I'll be part of that. But guess what? The massacre did not occur. It didn't happen. His final decree, just like Herod's life, proved to be empty and vain. Make the wiser choice. The path marked pride will lead you over a cliff. The path marked humility will bring us to the manger of the Messiah. So, final question. How do you want to end this year, 2015? We got less than a week left. How do you want to begin 2016? From this story and message of the first Christmas, from Bible history past, I want to be inspired and I want to be inspiring. I want to be a hero of faith like Mary, like Joseph, like shepherds, like wise men. I don't want to be annoying and destructive. You see, it's easy to be a villain. No prerequisites required, no preparation necessary. But to be a hero of faith, to be a heroine of faith, it requires a few things. Here's what it requires. I don't know if it's first, don't know that it's foremost, but it's one of the four things to be inspiring and to be inspired requires. Number one, we must trust God in the impossible moments of life. We must trust God in the impossible moments. Friday afternoon, as Shelley and Ashley and I jumped in the car to head to Modesto, I'm thinking, okay, Tim, in the last week of Shelley's dad's life, I could not be there with her. I'd just come home a day from the hospital. Wasn't doing good. Could not go. She made 7 trips in 8 days. I got there for the funeral. And I'm saying, Lord, I'm glad I could be with her now. I'm thinking, okay, it's weekend. You know what? I can call Gene and have him fill in the pulpit. I can call somebody and have him take that funeral. I heard God whisper, are you bailing out on the funeral so you can be with your wife, or are you bailing out on the funeral because you don't trust me to be big enough for an impossible moment? Since I wasn't quite sure what the answer really was, I said, okay. And then Shelley made it. He said, you know, Tim, don't drive me to Modesto. I want some alone time. And I understand that. I love tough times of life going on a long drive. But we've got to trust Him in the impossible moments that He can overcome. The other thing that's required is we must have patience in the anxious moments. I got a sneaking suspicion Mary got a little anxious when God said, you're pregnant. That would be. I got a sneaking suspicion Joseph got a little anxious when God said to Joseph, your fiance is pregnant. But patience persevered, and we know the end of the story. To be inspired and to be inspiring also requires humility in the heady moments. When you think you might deserve the pat on the back, you say, no, it's not about. It's not about the audience, except the audience of one. It's about God. And then last not because it's less important, but we must make wise choices at every moment of our life. Do you realize 10 wise choices from Sunday to Friday gets wiped out in a foolish choice on a Saturday? One foolish choice destroys a lot. It's similar to the business principle Mr. Jantz taught me 30-some years ago at the Bible House. Okay, 40 years ago at the Bible House. I hate saying that. When Mr. Jantz said, Tim, for every customer that you don't satisfy, they will tell 10 people how dissatisfied they are. For every customer you satisfy, they will tell 3 people. So you got to satisfy 4 times as many people to just barely break even. That principle is so true in wise choices and foolish choices. So we need to make wise choices at every moment. So we must trust. We must be humble and not think we're capable of handling these situations. And we must be patient. Give God time to work the outcomes out in His schedule, not ours. God pressed hard on me this week. If you were here Christmas Eve night, you heard me briefly talk about this. But God pressed on me, some of you have heard me. I've always been moaning the fact that for my first Christmas in 34 years, I didn't have a son with me. So I left the house Christmas Eve morning to do some errands and to do some things. Driving around town, a song kept coming into my head. I'm not one that songs always come to my head. It was an old hymn I grew up with, and it's Count Your Many Blessings, Name Them One by One. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. And this is the point that God drilled into my heart through that song. Tim, count your blessings. Don't number and itemize your frustrations and troubles. Okay? I asked Shelley Christmas Eve night, no setup for this. I just point blank asked her in front of everybody who was here Christmas Eve night. I said, babe, was my attitude different when I came home than when I left? And she said, light years. God was teaching. That was Christmas Eve day. Then Christmas Day comes. And I get the call on my cell phone from Shelley's brother-in-law that Shelley's mom had died. We had just unwrapped the last Christmas present at Dad's house, a present that had put a smile on the face of the recipient, and what I have to do now is to wrap my arms around my wife and tell her the news that is going to break her heart. And I said, okay, God, how do I apply this principle? Count your blessings, don't number your frustrations. I said, Betty's dead. And the whisper to my soul was this, yeah, she is, to you. But she's more alive to me than she's ever been before. I called her home, but remember, you saw her Wednesday evening. Count your blessings. I could be really frustrated this morning that the sanctuary expansion that was supposed to have been finished by Christmas Sunday this year hasn't even started. Or I can count my blessings that the Jam Center has been completed and it's thriving at the moment. I can be frustrated that this has been a year filled with personnel changes, or I can rejoice and count my blessings that for 15 years we had very little change in our staff at all. I count that a blessing. I count the blessings of God for challenging a Peggy Dunlap to step out of the corporate world and to go all in and to join our ministry support team. I count a blessing that God prepared in the heart of a preacher's kid, Chris Bishop, who went all the way to Australia for his education, prepared him to be our youth pastor. I count my blessings that God called a businessman and a pilot to become a preacher of the gospel. And Mark Addis. I count my blessings for providing Steve Brown to assist this coming year in our seniors' ministries. I could be annoyed this morning that In the last 4 months, I have 3 stents in my heart, or I can rejoice that God's not finished through me on earth yet. I can look back over this year and I can wallow in the low places, or I can reflect on walking through the valleys and discovering new mountaintops with sparkling vistas and the freshest air I've ever breathed. I mean, after all, Ivory Coast, Africa was awesome this year. More people from New Hope went than had ever been before. We've had the chance to make a difference in the lives of 60 kids. We're getting reports every single month of the difference that's taking place in that village. I can rejoice that Chad got married. I can rejoice that I got to go with Dad and Philip Wright on the honors flight to Washington, D.C., memories I'll cherish for all of my life. I can rejoice that New Hope baptized over 50 people in this baptistry this year. I can rejoice that the Jam Center is completed, that we got to celebrate Dad's 90th birthday. I found out I'm going to be a grandfather. I can rejoice that my daughter, sitting right back there, graduated from college this year. No more college bills. I can rejoice I successfully completed cardio rehab. I can celebrate the biggest year at New Hope for finances and mission giving we've ever had in the history of our church. The only valley that I could imagine this past week that will have a better mountaintop perspective than what I've witnessed this year is when I will walk for the final time through the valley David describes as the shadow of death. And I will walk out onto a mountaintop that is called heaven. But between now and then, whenever the then may come, I desire to be found fighting the good fight of faith with all the sufficiency of Christ. I desire to be found running the race that is spreading the gospel of God's grace. I desire to be found counting the generous blessings I've been given as I finish the course that God has laid out for me. How do you want to finish your year? How do you want to start your next year? If you don't want to be a Herod, it will require trust in impossible moments, and maybe you're living in one right now. It will require patience in your anxious moments, and maybe you are more anxious than you've ever been before. It will require humility in heady moments. Be willing to take the low road. It may require, it will require, wise choices at every moment. And maybe this is the moment to start with the wisest of all choices, putting faith in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. God, our Father, we look back and we say thank you. Thank you for the valleys. Thank you for the bumps in the road. Thank you for the mountaintops. Thank you for the maturity that takes place in the valleys, and thank you for the joys that we experience on the mountaintops. Father, as we attempt to box up the past and prepare for the future, may we do so, Father, only with your wisdom at work in us. May we realize that anything good in our past was when we were nothing and you were everything to us. And the only prospects of tomorrow being better than any of our yesterdays is when we trust your sufficiency above our own strength. So, fathers, if there's some villains in this sanctuary today, if there are some who have identified more with the pride of personal governing their own life, of arrogance, of thinking they have all the answers, of haughtiness that says, I can do it myself, Father, I pray that you will transform them into heroes and heroines by a simple prayer of confession and repentance. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Thank you that you're the difference maker. May we let you make the difference in our lives in days to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.